Hello, and thank you for tuning in today to our monthly concert from St. Jude's. This month, we're delighted to welcome Valerie Fry and Chris Hooker for a programme of poetry and music from the Second World War. Valerie will introduce the concert herself, but before she does that, I'd like to thank both her and Chris very gratefully for their generosity in presenting it.
Good afternoon, everyone. We're delighted to be back here with our clarinet, piano and poetry recital, and to have with us on this occasion, Chris Hooker, Geoff Chew, and I am Valerie Fry. Today our programme is about the Second World War, as this year marks the 75th anniversary of the end of the war. So all the music you'll hear was made popular at the time, and I'm sure all of the tunes will be familiar to you. The poetry may be less familiar. When we think of war poetry, we immediately think of World War I, but there is a wealth of material about World War II. And many of the poems you're going to hear were written by servicemen and women who fought, many of whom died, and were established poets when they were very young. It's a vast subject. Thousands of stories go untold, thousands of poems unread. But this is just a snapshot, a very small picture. Ladies and gentlemen, wind and words of the Second World War, we'll meet again. Going to, laughing men, for a holiday on the sea? Laughing, smiling, wonderful men, why won't you wait for me? God, how I love you, men of my race, as you smile on your way to a war. How can you do it, wonderful face? Do you not know what is before? Laugh, laugh, you soldier sons, joke on your way to the war, for your mothers won't laugh at the sound of the guns and the tales of the filth and the gore. Smile and joke, young Sailor Jack, for it's the self-same story. There'll be no jokes when you come back, and very little glory. Carrying my gas mask to school every day, buying savings stamps, remembering my national registration number, ZMGM/136/3. See, I can still remember it. Avoiding careless talk, digging for victory, looking for German spies everywhere. Oh yes, I did my bit for my country that long dark winter. Me and Winston and one or two others, wearing my tin hat whenever possible, singing Hang Out the Washing on the Siegfried Line, aircraft recognition charts pinned to my bedroom wall, the smell of paint on toy soldiers, doing paintings of Spitfires and Hurricanes, Lancasters and Halifaxes, along with a Heinkel or a Messerschmitt, plunging helplessly into the sea in the background. Pink light in the sky from Liverpool, burning 50 miles away. The thunder of daylight, flying fortresses high overhead, shaking the elderberry tree. Bright barrage balloons flying over the docks. Morning curve of the bay, seen from the park on the hill. After coming out of the air raid shelter, listening for the all clear siren, listening to Vera Lynn, Dorothy L'Amour, Alan Jones and the Andrews sisters, clutching my father's hand, tripping over the unfamiliar curb I walk over every day in the blackout.
Thank you.
These are the temporary rules introduced in 1940 by Richmond Golf Club. In competition during gunfire, or while bombs are falling, players may take cover without penalty for ceasing play. The position of known delayed action bombs are marked by a red flag at a reasonably but not guaranteed safe distance therefrom. A ball moved by enemy action, or if lost or destroyed, a ball may be dropped not nearer the hole without a penalty. A player whose stroke is affected by the simultaneous explosion of a bomb may play another ball from the same place. Penalty, one stroke. I've just been down to Plymouth. Did you know that lovely place before the trouble started? Well, you'd be broken-hearted if you could see it now. I tell you that. The mess the planes have made, acres laid flat. It's cruel, day and night, raid after raid. And how the people stick it out, God knows. I wouldn't know. But there they are, and stubborn, there they stay. They work all day between the bombs. At night, this moved me most, an hour before the sun goes down, they flock, the ruined people of the town, to listen to the band. Light music, nothing grand, and dance or watch the dancing on the hoe. Who dances? Oh, sailors, girls from a canteen, men at a warden's post, a couple from a salvaged home, or others who've lost everything. They come for company, to change their thoughts, to rest, and shabby clothes don't matter on the hoe. The water darkens, purple dyes the west, the hilltops lose their green, the stars begin to glow, blackout, as home they go, the plains are heard afar. This was the second summer of the war, yet every night sedately, so innocent and stately, the boys and girls were dancing. We're dancing on the hoe. The boys and girls of Plymouth were dancing on the hoe. After all these years, I can still close my eyes and see her sitting there in her big armchair, grotesque under an open sky, framed by the jagged lines of her broken house. Sitting there, a plump, homely person, steel needles still in her work rough hands, grey with dust, stiff with shock, but breathing. No blood or distorted limbs, breathing, but stiff with shock, knitting, unravelling on her aproned knee. They have taken the stretchers off my car, and I am running under the pattering flak over a mangled garden, treading on something soft and fighting the rising nausea. Only a far-flung cushion, bleeding feathers. They lift her gently out of her great armchair, tenderly under the open sky, a shock-frozen woman trailing khaki wool. There are flowers now, they say, at El Alamein. Yes, flowers in the minefields now. So those that come to view that vacant scene where death remains and agony has been will find the lilies grow. Flowers are nothing that we know. So they rang the bells for us and Alamein. Bells which we could not hear. And to those that heard the bells, what could it mean? The name of loss and pride, El Alamein. Not the murk and harm of war, but their hope, their own warm prayer. It will become a staid, historic name, that crazy sea of sand, like Troy or Agincourt, its single fame will be the garland for our brow, our claim, on us a fleck of glory to the end. And there our dead will keep their holy ground. But this is not the place that we recall, the crowded desert crossed with foaming tracks, the one blotched building lacking half a wall, the grey-faced men, sand-powered over all, the tanks, the guns, the trucks, the black, dark, smoking wrecks. So be it. None but us has known that land. El Alamein will still be only ours, and those 10 days of chaos in the sand, others will come who cannot understand, will halt beside the rusty minefield wires and find there flowers. Young are our dead. Like babies they lie, the wounds they blessed once, not healed dry. And yet too soon into each space, a cold earth falls on colder face. Quite still they lie, these fresh cut reeds, clutched in earth like winter seeds. But they will not bloom when called by spring to burst with leaf and blossoming. They sleep on in silent dust as crosses rot and helmets rust. I saw the general standing, part of a group, but somehow quite away, gazing silently as the army straggled, dispiritedly. It was late in the day. Studebakers passed with engines grinding. Tired men stared stolidly ahead, peering out from sleep-encrusted eyes, non-seeing as the wide-eyed dead. The rain, the very first we'd had this monsoon, had turned the dry and choking dust to mud. Luring clouds enveloped all the sky. The general made as if to walk away, paused a moment, then looked back again. To me there came, in that brief gesture, an aura of unutterable pain. So we must say goodbye, my darling, and go as lovers go forever. Tonight remains to pack on fix-on labels and make an end of lying down together. I put a final shilling in the gas and watch you slip your dress below your knees and lie so still I hear your rustling comb modulate the autumn in the trees. And all the countless things I shall remember lay mummy cloths of silence round my head. I fill the carafe with a drink of water. You say, We paid a guinea for this bed. And then we'll leave some gas, a little warmth for the next resident, and these dry flowers, and turn your face away, afraid to speak the big word that eternity is ours. Your kisses close my eyes, and yet you stare as though God struck a child with nameless fears. Perhaps the water glitters and discloses time's chalice and its limpid, useless tears. Everything we renounce except ourselves. Selfishness is the last of all to go. Our sighs are exhalations of the earth. Our footprints leave a track across the snow. We made the universe to be our home. Our nostrils took the wind to be our breath. Our hearts are massive towers of delight. We stride across the seven seas of death. Yet when all's done, you'll keep the emerald I placed upon your finger in the street. And I will keep the patches that you sewed on my old battle dress tonight, my sweet. With the 14th Army monsooned in South Asia, she placed the ring on her bedside table, wrote the Dear John letter to be airdropped in Burma. The Dear John letter, airdropped in Burma, hit her fiancé like a Japanese shell, weeping in Rangoon on a khaki shoulder. He traced all the loops, the dashes, the commas, sniffed the paper for her scent, her smell. gripped the Dear John letter, airdropped in Burma. An image, the thought another man would hold her. A tall man, a tea dance, the Piccadilly Hotel. Weeping in Rangoon on a khaki shoulder. 70 years on, she thinks of her soldier, carrying his grief in the Far Eastern hell, holding her Dear John letter, airdropped in Burma. Distance, war, a broken-hearted lover, guilt, newly risen, she cannot dispel, hearing his weeping in Rangoon on a khaki shoulder. Gone and the combatants gone, returning over the nightmare ground. We found the place again and found the soldier sprawling in the sun, the frowning barrel of his gun overshadowing. As we came on that day, he hit my tank with one like the entry of a demon. Look, here in the gun pit spoil, the dishonoured picture of his girl who has put Steffi, vergiss mein nicht, in a copybook Gothic script. We see him almost with content, abased, and seeming to have paid and mocked at by his own equipment that's hard and good when he's decayed. But she would weep to see today how on his skin the swart flies move, the dust upon the paper eye, and the burst stomach like a cave. For here, the lover and killer are mingled, who had one body and one heart, and death, who had the soldier singled, has done the lover mortal hurt.
Thank you.
Here are some tips for you American servicemen while you're in Britain. 1. The British are reserved, not unfriendly, so if they sit on trains or buses without striking up conversation with you, it doesn't mean they're being haughty. They don't speak to you because they don't want to appear intrusive or rude. 2. The British are tough. Don't be misled by the British tendency to be soft-spoken and polite. They can be plenty tough. 60,000 British civilians, men, women and children, have died under bombs, and their morale is unbreakable and high. A nation doesn't come through that if it doesn't have plain, common guts. 3. The British love their sport. The great spectator sports are football and cricket. Go see a match, you'll get a kick out of it. 4. They will like your frankness as long as it's friendly. The same sort of courtesy and decency and friendliness that go over big in America will go over big in Britain. They're not given to backslapping, and they're shy about showing their affections. But once they get to like you, they make the best friends in the world. 5. There are plenty of indoor amusements. The British have theatre and movies. The great place of recreation is the pub. The beer's a bit strange, but they're dance halls where you'll get to dance the best of swing. In the dark and listen. It's clear tonight, so they're flying high. Hundreds of them, thousands perhaps, riding the icy, moonlit sky. Men, materials, bombs and maps, altimeters and guns and charts, coffee, sandwiches, fleece-lined boots, bones and muscles and minds and hearts. English saplings with English roots, deep in the earth they've left below. Lie in the dark and let them go. Lie in the dark and listen. Lie in the dark and listen. They're going over in waves and waves, high above villages, hills and streams, country churches and little graves, and little citizens' worried dreams. Very soon they'll have reached the sea, and far below them will lie the bays and coves and sands, where they used to be taken for summer holidays. Lie in the dark and let them go. Lie in the dark and listen. Lie in the dark and listen, city magnates and steel contractors, factory workers and politicians, soft hysterical little actors, ballet dancers, reserved musicians, safe in your warm civilian beds. Count your profits and count your sheep. Life is flying above your heads. Just turn over and try to sleep. Lie in the dark and let them go. Theirs is a world you'll never know. Lie in the dark and listen. Official citation, Distinguished Flying Medal, Holmes Edward Keith, 575578, age 19, Sergeant, 102 Squadron, Flight Engineer, flying hours 166, sorties 30. On three occasions, his aircraft has been damaged by anti-aircraft fire, and twice he has returned to base on three engines. During the 1,000 bomber raid on Bremen, Sergeant Holmes manned the beam guns to attack shipping and searchlights from a low level. In his tour of operations, he has set a fine example of steadfast determination, courage, and devotion to duty, which fully merits this award. In this blue, hostile night, the anonymous below fear us and plot our end. The white icy blue moon patch slips over the scuffed alloy, marching tiny rivets. Silently sliding across the dove blue, black dull crucifix, a dark wing lifts. He joins us in our death suicide journey. Flaming white moon betrays us, reels above this black dull twin of us, lighting the tiny sheet of cloud. Fear in my guts, aching like before and before. My trade is to go in calm, murder my brothers, yes, sisters, and their young. Theirs to butcher me and roast my cringing meat. Frozen, the small sweat on my cheek, just at the edge of the mask. Must get a new one tomorrow. Tomorrow? Flock of feeble million digits parade orderly, their tale of engineering. 10:30. No, 10,500. Tired, the brain fumbles. I crave sleep to release these heavy eyelids. Tomorrow, tomorrow, tomorrow I'll sleep. One of my best friends was a gentleman by the name of Freddie Gardner. He was a great friend and also a great pianist. On our way from Bale up to Belgium, we went through Caen. There was a canteen in a bombed out church, and in the corner there was a grand piano with dust and bricks on top of it, completely covered. So we cleared the piano and Freddie got on that piano. Within 10 minutes, the place was heaving with hundreds of soldiers shouting out, "Play so and so, play this, play that." And Freddie played them all. Every request that was made, he played from memory. He was remarkable. The lads loved him. And for a moment, they forgot where they were and what they had been through. He was a great friend. So sorry to lose my pal Freddie. come and stand in memory of men who fought and died. They gave their lives in Normandy. Remember them with pride. Soldiers, airmen, sailors, airborne and marines, who in civvy life were tailors and men who worked machines. British and Canadian and men from USA, forces from the Commonwealth, they all were there that day. To Juneau, Sword and Utah, beaches of renown, also Gold and Omaha, that's where the ramps went down. The battle raged in Normandy. Many lives were lost. The war must end in victory, and this must be the cost. When my life is over and I reach the other side, I'll meet my friends from Normandy and shake their hands with pride. We thought we had seen it all. Our cheeks bloomed like peaches, bright eyes, quick light movement, flashes of scarlet, snow-white caps. We thought we had seen it all. The London Blitz, bombs, fires, headless corpses, screaming children, Yankee Doodle Dandy. We thought we had seen it all. Scabies, lice and impetigo, TB, polio, and unmentionable VD. We thought we had seen it all. Then France. Day followed night, and then another day of mangled, broken boys, Irish, Welsh, and Scots, Jerrys, Poles, and French. They cried in many tongues as needles long and sharp advanced. Their blood ran very red, and so they died. We thought we had seen it all. Our souls shrank deep and deeper still, until with nowhere else to go, soft hearts hardened and cocooned themselves. Laughter broke like glass over fields and orchards and from tent to tent. We tried We really tried, but some, they died. We thought we had seen it all, until Belsen. There are no words to speak. We hid within our souls, deep and silent. We clung together, trying to understand. The smell pervaded the mind, and the sights and sounds reached those souls buried deep within, and for so long encased in rock. Bitter, scalding tears melted the rock. Our hearts were broken. We had seen it all. I am the man who looked for peace and found my own eyes barbed. I am the man who groped for words and found an arrow in my hand. I am the builder whose firm walls surround a slipping land. When I grow sick or mad, mock me not, nor chain me. When I reach for the wind, cast me not down. Though my face is a burnt book and a wasted town.